of Agriculture to chair this interagency working group to ensure coordination on cooperative development among federal agencies and private sector organizations. We are honored to have such an important role in supporting cooperative development. The working group first convened in 2014 and met a number of times over several years to discuss cooperative development, the needs of the cooperative community, and how the federal government can further assist cooperatives. The Biden administration reconvened the working group in October 2021 to address priorities including climate, the food chain, the care economy, and cooperative conversions. This working group serves as a forum where government agencies and cooperative stakeholders can talk about current issues facing cooperative businesses. Creating a climate committee gives us the opportunity to highlight current issues in environmental sustainability facing the United States and cooperative businesses in particular. Together, we can think about how cooperatives are impacted by climate change and how we can help each other to adapt to it or mitigate its effects. We can also discuss how cooperatives can benefit from federal programs focusing on climate sustainability. We will start our meeting today with Bengay Ajalar, Senior Advisor to the Rural Development Undersecretary, who will welcome you and describe Rural Development's Climate Adaptation Plan. Stephanie Bezruki, Chief of Staff of Rural Business Cooperative Service, will discuss how cooperative businesses have operated as an effective economic development tool. Then a panel of experts will describe practices and technologies that may be used to remediate climate change. After the panel discussion, we'll open it up to comments, thoughts, and questions on how other federal resources could support cooperatives. We anticipate that this meeting will help to develop a platform for sharing information on available government and stakeholder programs and resources for cooperatives. Foster the working relationships among government agencies and cooperative stakeholders to facilitate the use of the cooperative model to solve problems and continue to educate federal and non-federal participants regarding the operation of cooperatives and the value of cooperative development. This morning, our attendance consists of people from the USDA, from other federal agencies, and from various outside cooperative stakeholders. Given the time constraint we're under and the number of people involved, we won't be able to do comprehensive introductions. However, if you would like to provide your name and association in the chat, we will be grateful for that. Also, if you have questions, we ask that you put them in the chat as well. And if we can get to them after we have our speakers, we will. And if we don't get to all the questions or comments, we'll certainly try to answer them afterwards by email or phone. Now I'd like to introduce Ulug Benga Ajalar, Senior Advisor in the Office of the Undersecretary for Rural Development. Previously, Benga served as a senior economist at the Center for American Progress and former president of the National Economic Association. He holds a PhD in economics from Claremont Graduate University and a bachelor's degree from the University of California, Berkeley. Benga?
Thank you, Fred, and thank you for that nice introduction. And I also like to thank RBCS for this invitation to talk. And so I'm gonna provide brief remarks on the recent climate adaptation plan that was released by Rural Development. So again, I'm in the Undersecretary's office, and I work on a lot of the equity and climate initiatives. So that includes a lot of the work from the Executive Order 14008. That includes the Justice Initiative, Justice 40 Initiative, and the Climate Adaptation Plan. In our Climate Adaptation Plan, what we do is we outline the risks to rural America, and then and also to RD's portfolio. And one of the things, as this audience would know, that there's a lot of adverse climate risks. You know, right now I've been thinking about Kentucky and the terrible floods that they've been going through. A lot of that, what we want to do is create this tool, a mapping tool, that would basically look at climate risks as well as our portfolio, as well as look at social vulnerability. And we want to create this tool to be able to anticipate these events like what's happened in Kentucky, and then from there take actions, try to figure out actions to try to mitigate the harm, to go in with disaster resources, things like that. And so also to kind of anticipate, you know, there might be, need to be some infrastructure upgrades. And this way we can try to like effectively and efficiently target these things so we can do that. So the goal, the main point of the Climate Adaptation Plan is basically to try to anticipate what's going to be happening as these climate events get a lot larger. After I'm going to put a link to the USDA's Climate Adaptation Plan. There's a whole website that all the different missionaries have, and then also put a link to Rural Development's Climate Adaptation Plan. I also put my information in the chat for if anyone has any questions or comments about it. So thank you very much. Back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much. Now I'd like to introduce the USDA Rural Business Cooperative Service Chief of Staff, Stephanie Bezruki. During nearly 7 years on Capitol Hill, Stephanie served in a variety of leadership positions, including most recently as legislative director for former Congresswoman Abby Finkenauer, and previously as senior policy advisor for Congresswoman Sherry Bustos. She holds a bachelor's degree from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Stephanie?
Hi, Fred, and thank you so much for that warm introduction, and hello to everybody, and thank you for attending our discussion today on cooperatives and climate. During my time this afternoon, I've been asked to provide a picture of how successful and effective cooperatives can be, especially as economic development tools. The Rural Business Cooperative Service has been keeping track of statistics on agricultural cooperatives for 100 years. These statistics and the history that they show us, they prove that cooperatives generate jobs, deliver on goods and services, especially when there are market failures, and are especially resilient in economic downturns. And I don't think that this is a surprise to anyone here on the line today, but we know that cooperatives operate in so many sectors of our economy, not just agriculture. And to list off a few: utilities, food, financial services, construction, healthcare, education, and so many more. 76% of agricultural cooperatives, they've been in existence for over 50 years or more. I think this is proof of the level of resiliency for all cooperatives, which are particularly important given the circumstances that our country is facing today. And as framing for our discussion today, cooperatives, they've been shown to be stewards of land and water and provide energy to rural America. The logos on the slide are samplings of household name agricultural cooperatives. Some of these you may not even realize they were cooperatives. And of course, there's also our electric co-ops, worker cooperatives like Namaste Solar and Ohio Cooperative Solar that provide solar installation services, and timber cooperatives as well that play in this space. As a refresher for folks here today, what makes cooperatives such a great development tool is that the member patrons of the cooperative own, finance, use, and democratically control the cooperative. Ownership of the cooperative allows members to build wealth. The financial benefits from the cooperative's business then remain with the member patron in the form of patronage refunds. The more that a member uses that cooperative, the more patronage money that member receives. And then in turn, that money stays in the local community and circulates where they live and work. The democratic governance of the cooperative has benefits individually for each of those members as well. Members run the cooperative together, they learn business skills and network with each other. At the same time, this is building capacity in that local community. It's also important to look closely at whether a cooperative qualifies for federal programming. It's easy to make a mistake and exclude cooperatives from federal programs, especially since not all cooperatives are the same. They really need to be looked at one by one. Part of that, the reason there is cooperatives can vary state and by entity. One area of confusion that I understand involves a cooperative's tax status. Generally, they take the form of cooperatives tax under subchapter T of the IRS code, but some are taxed like partnerships and a few are exempt organizations. While C corporations are required to focus on delivering profits to their shareholders, cooperatives have many goals beyond just profits. This includes helping their members, employees, supplier, other cooperatives, and the environment. These are all goals that I feel really align with the priorities of this administration and speak to the importance of cooperatives at this moment in history. Since those cooperatives are democratic organizations, each member has a voice in how the businesses are run. That lets these cooperatives be creative, especially in times of crisis. In the case of worker cooperatives, for example, members can vote to change their operations or opt to take smaller paychecks rather than dismiss workers or simply go out of business. Farmers, they can change how they market and process their produce. And cooperative grocers, they can rely on relationships they have with locally sourced producers and other flexibilities to address supply chain issues. Of course, our broadband, electric, and farmer cooperatives, these are all examples of businesses that address community needs that might otherwise go unmet. As you know, this meeting today is to foster cooperative development and ensure coordination with federal agencies, as well as with the strong stakeholders who support cooperative programs and interests. I hope this group can seize on the opportunity to make programs across the federal government better known and understood, and really bring people both within government and outside of government together around this shared vision. I also want to let you know that our federal cooperative resource webpage. We've gathered USDA resources and a single PDF file. And we plan to update this, so please don't be surprised when and if our team reaches out to gather additional information for the resource as it continues to grow and evolve. I now have the great pleasure of introducing an incredible leader and champion in this space, Doug O'Brien, president of the National Cooperative Business Association, who will describe some of the cooperative needs in the environmental and energy space. Go ahead, Doug.
Thank you, Stephanie. And thank you again, USDA team, for Administrator Neal and the whole team for continuing this conversation with the Interagency Cooperative Development Working Group. And thanks especially to their federal colleagues in the different agencies. It's such an important conversation. I think Kabenga and Stephanie did a fantastic job talking about the capacity and some of the history of co-ops. I'll just emphasize that a little bit. And I want to ask a couple of my colleagues from the cooperative community, Lisa Van Dorn and Russ Lawson, in a few minutes to weigh in here too. But, you know, cooperatives over the generations have been used as solution machines, and they've been able to do it at scale. The two big examples that we think of at the National Cooperative Business Association, where I work, we think about the rural electric cooperatives that in the early 1930s, only 10% of rural people had access to electricity, while fully 90% of people in cities had that. With the work of cooperatives, farmers and other rural people coming together in member-owned, you know, businesses, within a generation, that number went up to 90% of rural people had access. And it was because of people coming together to solve a problem of access to electricity. It was also because of some really important federal, federal programs that supported in technical assistance, in capacity building, and in financing. And, you know, those are three areas maybe I'll come back around to when we think about how cooperatives can make a bigger impact and be a bigger part of the solution. Another example is agriculture cooperatives that in the late 1800s and early 20th century farmers found themselves in a different place. They kind of lost their place in the market as an agrarian economy was moving into an industrialized one. Farmers came together in cooperatives to make sure that they had the scale, that they had the business acumen, and that they had the ability to come together to solve that problem. And as Stephanie did a great job describing, what a wildly successful venture that was. Again, it was because of these individuals, these American citizens coming together in this special kind of business. It was also because of some significant federal support in terms of, again, technical assistance, helping with cooperative development in the early years, some important financing and some tax policy that really supports this special type of business. Those are two big examples that roll right into, I think, Stephanie's question is, what would cooperatives need to help be a bigger part of the solution to today's challenges around the environment and climate? And certainly we all know that those are huge challenges that must be dealt with. And there's some really exciting programs coming down the pike. So we think about those three legs to the stool, financing programs, and whether that's, some type of subsidized loan or, a grant for some type of startup. Those are key policies. The tax policies that were touched on earlier, cooperatives, given that they're that special type of business of member use, ownership, and benefit are appropriately taxed at one level instead of two. There's other strategies that that cooperatives could use in the tax realm to make sure that they have the opportunity and the viability to build out, these different types of systems that will make a big difference. And then that other one is technical assistance. Many of these, types of tactics and approaches around energy, around environment, around different types of approaches to help the environment, they're highly technical. They require deep expertise, and the federal government can provide that expertise themselves or help subsidize and fund some of that expertise. So people in local communities can really leverage, a big opportunity. I'll just mention one other kind of idea. When you think of what the power of cooperatives, we talked about this amazing group of rural electric cooperatives. I'm going to hand it to Russ here in just 1 minute, and agriculture cooperatives. And there are many, many other ways that co-ops could be brought to bear. For instance, co-ops that are designed to provide environmental services. What if farmers and citizens came together in a cooperative to be able to, to capture different types of environmental pollutants or carbon, and they'd be able to get to that scale so that they'd be able to participate, in the market in a much more equitable way, so that the value of that environmental service is brought down into the local community, into the households and farms in those rural communities. That's the power of a cooperative. Similarly, the power of information. Much of what we talk about in environmental services, it's really zeros and ones. It's data. What if we make sure that the people who are creating that information, they control that information, they make sure that they are able to capture as much value from that information with new practices and services. These are just a few ideas, and ideas on how the federal government can partner with cooperatives to make a bigger impact. I do want to call on Lisa Van Dorn with the National Council of Farmer Cooperatives to weigh in here with a similar question. Lisa.
Thanks, Doug, and would absolutely echo everything you've said. Thank you for having me again. Lisa Van Dorn, I'm with the National Council of Farmer Cooperatives. Farmer co-ops and their farmers and ranchers that own them, they've been at the front lines of climate change and the challenges associated with that, from more frequent droughts to heavier and more variable rainfall. These extreme weather events and the shift in growing seasons can impede crop and livestock production, threaten food and ag livelihoods, and ultimately undermine our global food security. So we've taken this issue on very seriously, and our farmer members are, innovating and rising to the challenge. As stewards of the land, they have an enormous opportunity to drive solutions that reduce greenhouse gas emissions, build resiliency through the food and ag value supply chains. And we strongly believe that there is a federal policy can and should provide incentives and support to ensure that co-ops and their farmer and rancher owners benefit from their role in developing and driving these climate solutions. I think, Doug, for us, most importantly, and what we've really applaud USDA for doing is taking a voluntary, incentive-based, you know, locally-led approach to how we address the climate crisis. And we've seen that in almost everything that's come out of USDA in recent months. And we applaud the department for what they've been doing. You know, there are ways that you can support the co-op in this mission by supporting and develop oversight of private sector markets for greenhouse gas credits. Some of our members are involved in, you know, doing some of those private sector markets and are on the forefront of that. I think there's other ways that you can promote and incentivize the public-private partnership and the opportunity for co-ops to serve as that trusted resource. Oftentimes, the farmer goes to the co-op for that technical assistance or advice on what they should be doing on farm. So making sure that we bolster what co-ops are able to do and have the tools to incentivize farmers and ranchers to prioritize and scale up climate smart practices, I think it's a really big key for us. And ultimately making sure that co-ops are eligible to be that partner with the department on this big issue. I'm happy to answer any questions, Doug, or toss it over to Russ or back to you.
Thank you, Lisa. Yeah, I'm gonna hand it to Russ in just a minute. I think those are excellent points, Lisa, in terms of making sure that co-ops are eligible. The voluntary incentives are such a key point. I'll mention co-op development itself. The Rural Cooperative Development Grant Program is housed at USDA. It's such an important program to help people establish new cooperatives to provide solutions. But I do want to hand it to Russ Rawson at the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association for a few comments. Russ.
Thank you, Doug. And it's so nice to be asked to participate in this. As you may know, electric cooperatives are very capital intensive. And quite honestly, we can't have modern civilization without electricity. And looking at the transition to eventually a zero carbon based future, you know, electricity is going to play a larger and larger role. And so it's critical to NRECA and our members to be able to make that transition in such a way that we can achieve our strategic goal of reliable and affordable power. And I sent Megan a fact sheet earlier today, and I asked her to share it with all of you because it contains a lot of data about how electric cooperatives have been transitioning over the last few years to a lower carbon future. Now, one thing I want to agree with everything Lisa said. You know, it's critical for us as capital intensive industries to have incentives to keep our cost as low as possible. Because as you know, as cooperatives, we operate at cost. You know, in the case of electric cooperatives, we operate on a not-for-profit basis. So we earn margins based on our mortgage covenants, but we return those margins to our members over time. And that's how we achieve at cost operation. But the most critical thing for us at the moment is to maintain a reliable and resilient electric grid. And it's just absolutely a national security issue. There's just no way you can say it's not. And so in conjunction with doing that, we applaud the efforts that have been done in Congress through the infrastructure bill, and then just recently through the reconciliation, or what we call the reconciliation bill, the Inflation Reduction Act. There were a number of things in there for cooperatives, such as direct pay, tax credits for renewables and those types of things, carbon capture and sequestration. Direct pay is critical for us because the vast majority of our members are tax exempt, and they cannot use tax credits as other taxable entities might. So having direct pay as a legislative option for us is absolutely critical if we're going to make this transition to a lower and reduce carbon future. It's something that we've been promoting for some time now, and we are hopeful that this reconciliation bill will ultimately make it into law and be signed by the president. If there's anything that I can add, or if I'd be happy to take any questions from any of you, Doug, I'll turn it back over to you at this time, if that's appropriate.
Okay, there you go. I'll put my $5 in the jar. Thank you, Russ. Great comments. I'll hand it right back to Megan. I know there's a lot more great content, I'll just speak for Russ and Lisa and the National Cooperative Business Association. We so appreciate the opportunity to be part of this conversation with the federal family. It's such an important conversation. Thank you, USDA.
Thank you very much, Doug. Well, we're going to transition a little bit now, change the pace up. And I have some bad news for you folks. James Lovelock, the creator of GIA ecology theory, he passed away July 26th, last Tuesday. His inventions are credited in part with making Rachel Carson's work possible, with obtaining an international ban on chlorofluorocarbons, and with the recognition in the scientific community that minute changes in our environment can have an immense impact on our climate. The good news, he was 103. Our environment is partly about the physical world, which is bound by a thin layer of atmosphere on this nearly round globe, with a small layer of soils, some of which are fertile, growing roughly 95% of the food we eat. It's also about what we do, what we as humans collectively put into our environment. The Center for Disease Control and the Prevention recently found that 80% of Americans have glyphosate in their bodies. News about our environment does get attention with stories about heat waves, forest fires, and floods. Not so much where we are on the Keeling curve. We are suffering from prolonged droughts in the West and Southwest, so much so that Great Salt Lake is low enough on the water levels that it's feared that calcium, sulfur, and arsenic in the lake bed will pollute Salt Lake's air. When it comes to finding environmental solutions for our climate, our air, water, land, and our food supply, we rely on cooperative collection and international agreements. There aren't a lot of environmental cooperatives per se, but agriculture and forestry producers and cooperatives are impacted by ecology. Today, we want to think about the big picture. How do we collectively act to improve economic development, positively impacting our environment, and why cooperatives might be a better model for doing that? Let's turn to our experts who are working proactively with optimism, enthusiasm, and to learn more about how science, technology, and human behavior can make our environment better, how we can empower and use cooperatives to be part of that change. So let me introduce, I'll run through everybody, and then we'll get to questions. Roger Ames, he is the Energy Program Chief Scientist at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, the co-author of Championing Science, Communicating Your Ideas to Decision Makers, and Bending the Curve, Climate Change Solutions Digital Textbook. He's also the holder of more recent U.S. patents than I have in years of federal service. Alexander Poukoulis. He's the director of the Bioindustry Division at AFRI Management Consulting, a global consulting design and engineering services firm. At AFRI, Dr. Poukoulis is responsible for providing strategic advisory services to clients in the pulp, paper, biochemicals, and related industry. Dr. Poukoulis has held senior prior leadership positions at International Paper, led the Hurdy Advanced Materials Development Center, founded A2K Consultants. He also developed the first biodegradable coffee cup, and he's been a working consultant on several 9003 program applications. Vanessa McKinney, she is the program manager for EPA's AgStar program, where she works with U.S. livestock, biogas, and government stakeholders to advance deployment of digesters and biogas systems. She has over a decade of experience in energy efficiency, renewable energy, and air emissions regulations and policy. Vanessa is a colleague and an incredible resource for USDA's partnership with EPA in the AgStar partnership. Craig Metz, he's the founder, president, and CEO of NSAVE. His company has worked extensively with rural development programs as a technical service provider to NRCS. Since 1991, NSAVE has consulted with leaders in the public and private sectors to deliver sustainability solutions for agricultural and rural communities, including rural electric cooperatives. Julian Reyes, who's joined us, I see. He is the National Climate Hubs Coordinator, a former U.S. State Department employee in the Office of Global Change, Bureau of Oceans and International Environmental and Scientific Affairs, a former fellow in science and technology with the American Association for Advancement of Science, with a PhD in civil engineering from Washington State University. Fernell Thompson, she's a working colleague within our Rural Business Cooperative Service team, a procurement professional whom we lovingly refer to as the First Lady of BioPreferred. She manages the BioPreferred program, its contractors, the 139 product categories, and federal procurement priorities with that program. Siraj Upaya, he is part of the Sea Change Consortium for Cultivating Human and Naturally Regenerative Enterprises at Iowa State University, which was awarded $10 million in Sustainable Agricultural Systems grant from the USDA through NIFA, the National Institute of Food and Agriculture. Siraj has a PhD in philosophy from the Warnell School of Forestry and Natural Resources at the University of Georgia. His research and teaching is focused on the areas of socio-ecological systems and human dimensions of natural resource management. So let me start, if I can, with Roger. We've previously discussed models and methods for sequestering carbon dioxide from ethanol plants. Some of those plants are cooperatives, and many are supplied with crops from cooperatives. What developments are new with those efforts to sequester carbon dioxide? How important is that effort to be accelerated? Do you think that a cooperative model could be used to build pipelines to move carbon dioxide? Roger, I think you might be on mute. Hello?
Yeah.
Roger?
It's not unmuting.
You're not. Maybe you could bump up your mic or speak louder.
Ah, there we go. Okay. Thank you for bringing me here today, Fred, and it's a pleasure to meet you all. Can you hear me now?
I can.
Okay, so the carbon management is a big deal to the Department of Energy, and the participation of rural cooperatives and rural industry business in general is an increasingly large part of the Department of Energy's interest here. The new Assistant Secretary for Fossil Energy and Carbon Management, note the new name, is Brad Crabtree, who has managed the Great Plains Institute for many years and has a great interest in this issue of putting CO2 from ethanol plants underground and increasing now the feedstocks. Ethanol was a convenient place to start, but increasingly waste from agricultural processing is half carbon. That carbon can be put underground permanently. And in the new Inflation Reduction Act, that's explicitly called out as something that will be very strongly supported financially. So the opportunity to have direct pay there and to build those facilities is something that the government is very much increasing the overlap between energy and agriculture. And the opportunity for agricultural cooperatives to have a new business line that basically manages carbon is exactly what the government wants to create today. So that's the opportunity that I think exists, and that I think a lot of the discussion today can focus on how do we make that better for you.
Thank you. Craig, NSAVE has extensive experience delivering technical services to the Natural Resource Conservation Service and with rural development programs. What kind of work have you done with cooperatives, including the rural electric utilities, and what effect do you think that work has had on the environment? And how do you see the role of cooperatives in improving the environment and dealing with climate changing circumstances? And do you think that cooperatives offer any advantages to delivering energy efficiency and renewable energy over other utilities?
Well, thank you, Fred, for the invitation to talk. I think that the rural electric co-ops do the best they can, given some of the constraints that they have on dollars for energy efficiency. Many co-ops do a very, very good job with energy efficiency, and some not as well as they could, but there's constraints on those costs. I think that one of the things that co-ops could do more to engage with energy efficiency is we run a lot of programs with state energy offices or other entities. And if we can work closer together with those co-ops, I think that there could be more benefit to be able to bring more energy efficiency and reducing carbon emissions in doing that. I think that we've worked very, very well with electric co-ops. I think that it's something that we would like to see them engage more on. And I think one of the things that I'd like to just make a couple points on, I think that as far as NRCS is concerned, it's concerning that they are stepping away from energy efficiency now. Their concentration is more on soil health. And at a time when we have energy efficiency that is so important to be able to reduce their costs, farmers' costs, as well as the environmental benefits of energy efficiency, we would like to see them, you know, make a bigger commitment to that end of the industry. I think one of the other things I just want to mention on the electric co-ops is beneficial electrification. I think it's a real big win for the electric co-ops, and I think that they can help lead the way. And there's many irrigation projects where those projects are run with diesel engines. They can be easily converted to electric turbine, and we run programs like that, and there needs to be more opportunity with that. And the other point I just want to make, Fred, is that with the farm changing and more electric vehicles coming online, like tractors or skid steers or other vehicles on the farm, there needs to be more incentive or way to loan guarantees to be able to finance mobile equipment. We understand some of the issues with mobile equipment, but it is something that if we're going to move towards electrifying the farm, we have to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Alex, we see occasional news stories about revising the paper and pulp mills. I mean, we go back to Flambeau River, and as an expert in the paper industry, what do you see as realistic to reinvigorate that industry? Is the 9003 program a way to move forward, or are there more conventional, meaning lower loan amount programs or grants that would be just as valuable? And also, how do we use more wood and fiber in the value chain? And because I might not have time to ask every question as a follow-up, but it seems there's been a lot of interest on energy projects, but you know, there's really interest in other things. So what are the other market opportunities outside of the energy space that that you think should be considered?
Well, Fred, thanks for the invitation. It's a great panel. I'm actually learning a lot, so I appreciate being here. Unfortunately, there are paper mills, pulp and paper mills throughout the country that have become uncompetitive and have been forced to shut down. And some of them have transitioned, but largely most of them have not. And I think when looking at these facilities, I think we need to kind of look holistically. And I think it's really important that we understand the opportunity. And I think it's part of the AgStar program where you plan for success and you recruit an experienced team to get the job done. But there's a lot that can be gained by really understanding the local resource and what can be done with the existing facility, how to redeploy it, et cetera, and maximize the value of the forest resource. I think when it comes to forest resources, fiber in the form of wood or pulp or some value-added component is really the overarching goal. I don't believe that utilizing whole trees for things like power generation is probably the best use for that resource. That being said, I think that you can really leverage the resource by thinking holistically and incorporating different businesses within that, within that that site. So it really, it's the plan and how you deploy it that is going to be the defining component for success. So you asked me a lot of questions. So how do you make that happen? Well, I think the 9003 program is perfect, and you see a lot of mega projects that are being considered for these sites and greenfield sites that are utilizing wood. And quite frankly, the limit on the 9003, I think it's 250 million. Some of these projects are exceeding 1 billion in scale because they're incorporating not only things like wood to Fischer-Tropsch liquids and biofuel production, but they're also including carbon sequestration. So a lot of these mega projects have gotten extremely large, but there are a lot of things that can be done small scale. And what do I mean by that? Well, you know, power generation is certainly one of them, and that's a perfect opportunity for Cooperative. You can also do energy pellets, black pellets, white pellets. There are pyrolysis oils and various other chemicals that can be derived from wood. And these can be done at small scale. No one has been successful at it, but the technologies, I think, are becoming more and more viable. And with all of the new legislation that is enhancing the revenue streams from these components, I think there's a real opportunity to do that. And then, so what else can you do from these wastes and various other sources of both ag and forestry residues? Well, there's a lot of interest from consumer products companies, brand owners, et cetera, to produce sustainable packaging and materials. And there's so many examples where ag waste, Stover and so forth, are being used to produce thermoform products that can go into packaging, food service applications. And there's no reason why that can't be expanded. And by the way, I think there's a great example in Tennessee where we have a cooperative that had done that and is now formed out into a privately owned company. But the point is that, you know, this can aggregate local feedstocks and bring it together to create value.
Thank you. For the benefit of our audience that isn't familiar with what 9003 is, it's the Biorefinery Assistance Loan Guarantee Program, Renewable Chemical and Bio-Based Product Program, or very close to that. For now, we were talking about wood, fiber, but not food. And so I think it's a perfect segue to talk about those two things, the wood and fiber. They're really the building materials for the Bio-Preferred Program. So could you tell us more about Bio-Preferred and how it fits into the environment and why it's so important to the economy?
Okay. Hello, everyone. Happy, fantastic Friday to everyone again. If you did not hear me when I first got on. Fred, I'm going to break your question down into two parts, okay? I'm going to deal with the environment first. Okay. Yes, plant fiber. Wood fiber, plant fiber is a common feedstock used in the manufacture of bio-based products, as other renewable resources, such as plant oils, enzymes, algae, wood-based food feedstocks that are produced, grown, harvest, and manufactured in innovative ways. In fact, there are over 500 bio-based feedstocks that are used in the creation of products that have received the USDA certified bio-based product label. As far as the environmental advantages of the bio-based products and the study commissioned by the USDA bio-based products, it was found that it displaced about 9.4 million barrels of oil a year. It also has the potential to reduce greenhouse gas emissions because some of our products are made with plants, and plants do sequester carbon during their growing season, during the growing system. So they do reduce greenhouse gas emissions for climate change. There are 12.7 million metric tons of CO2 equivalent per year. It also slows the climate change by sequestering, again, CO2 from the atmosphere, which would help our climate. To participate in a biofuel program, manufacturers must prove their product meet at least one of the program's innovative criteria, which includes sustainability criteria. Okay, that's all the environmental stuff. If you have questions, please put them in the chat. As far as the economy is concerned, in the study, as commissioned by the USDA, the biofuel products industry contributed $470 billion to the U.S. economy in 2017. That's a pretty big number, and that's pretty important. The bio-based industry also supported 4.6 million jobs in the U.S., in the United States. That's a pretty big number too, 4.6 million jobs. We created jobs. Bio-based products manufactured in the United States are often made using locally sourced materials, creating new markets for farm commodities, jobs near the farm gate, and a thriving rural America. And as you know, the BioFair program is in the Rural Business Cooperative Service Division. And we do have two cooperatives that do participate in our program. One of them sells bio-based fertilizer. The name of is Eau Claire Cooperative Oil Company. They sell, their product is registered with us as a bio-based fertilizer. They have a certified bio-based label and for federal procurement. And federal procurement is a mandated product category for federal agencies and federal contractors to buy, just in case you didn't know that. And we also have another one, it's called the Heartland Corn Products. They have a product registered with us called Gas Fuel Additives, and they're also federal procurement. Okay, Fred.
All right, thanks, Fernell. Vanessa, I want to talk a little bit about AgStar's work. I know it's really central in the effort to reduce methane emissions. And dairy digesters are a major part of that work. Have cooperatives been adapting those practices with anaerobic digesters? And what about nutrient recovery? What do you see happening there? Is that another revenue stream? How many more digesters could the United States build? And is there more room in the development of the dairy sector as opposed to the swine sector, perhaps using a cooperative model? And lastly, what are the obstacles that you know you see as obstacles to development and deployment?
Sure thing. And thank you so much for the kind introduction earlier, Fred. This makes me blush. Generally the AgStar program, you're correct. We promote anaerobic digesters as a way to reduce methane emissions. However, that's not the only thing that digesters do. Digesters are a really great use for managing your manure on a farm, getting the most out of the nutrients, ensuring that pathogens are destroyed reusing the fiber that is common in the manure and being able to use it as bedding on your farm. So you're reducing costs at the facility as well as creating energy, being able to use waste energy at your facility, and then sometimes turning around and making consumer products with the digestate that results from anaerobic digesters. So to your point about revenue streams, anaerobic digesters do provide a revenue stream for farms, not only in cost savings from reducing their expenses on the farm, but creating products that can be saleable to consumers or to the electric grid or gas grid. We see cooperatives more and more interested in digesters, and there is certainly a new and emerging mechanism for groups of farms to work together and have one central digester. This is a type of anaerobic digester that we call a cluster project, and we're seeing those pop up in California and facilities managed by a single farmer cooperative, such as like Smithfield in Utah and Missouri and North Carolina. So this creates an enormous opportunity to grow the market. The market potential, AgStar had a report called our Market Opportunities Report in 2018. And we estimated that the potential number of digesters in the United States could exceed 8,000. But this was an estimate that we did really before the concept of cluster projects really came on the scene. And the great thing about cluster projects is that we can now include smaller farms that may not have been economical or provided enough product or manure to feed a digester and enable them to become part of a cluster project digesting manure. So we think the market potential greatly exceeds 8,000, we have to get a little bit better data to figure out what that might be, because it's very location specific. We need facilities to be really close together, and that's a bit of an optimization problem that we don't quite have a handle on yet. The opportunity for dairy is immense, and you had asked a question about dairy cooperatives. Dairy is really low-hanging fruit in the industry of anaerobic digestion, because dairy cattle do have so much potential for anaerobic digestion, because they naturally contain a type of bacteria that creates our biogas product out of the digestion process. So essentially, continually feeding a digester with dairy manure is inoculating the system with methanogenic bacteria that keeps that process operating and going. Across the country, we're seeing more emphasis on reducing landfill waste and diverting organics from landfills. If dairy cooperatives have the ability to host a digester that is technologically feasible to digest food waste, that offers yet another revenue stream for those facilities, as they can accept tipping fees for receiving food waste from local entities, such as grocery stores or large institutional facilities like universities or hospitals. So that's yet another growing part of the anaerobic digester sphere that we see in this industry that we're keeping an eye on.
Thanks, Vanessa. Julian, you're perhaps the youngest person on the panel that is almost a climatologist or a climate scientist. And you have this international experience for what is really a global system in terms of what's happening, how we can reduce emissions. So I just have to ask you, what do you see happening with our climate environment? Do you see temperature increase as affecting crop yields? Given that many cooperatives are agricultural in nature, how are the climate hubs a good working resource for cooperatives?
Thanks, Fred. I hope you all can hear me. Also, similar to Vanessa, thanks for that great introduction. I always forget that I've done a lot of things, and it's led me to a really great federal agency with the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So the USDA Climate Hubs are a unique cross-agency program. We link the research agent, the great research happening at NIFA, ARS, Forest Service, with the program agencies, NRCS, Rural Development, FSA, RMA. And Fred, to your point, through our work, we really want to provide place-based, locally led impacts and solutions to our partners and stakeholders, which can include cooperatives. And so, you know, we take the best science available, and we co-develop or co-produce tools, syntheses, you know, with stakeholders, with cooperatives, with rural communities. And so on our website, you'll find local, state-based, regionally-based, science-based information on, for example, what do higher temperatures mean for the Corn Belt, or what does decreasing groundwater over the Ogallala Aquifer mean for wheat and cotton, especially in the panhandle of Texas and Oklahoma, for example. So the climate hubs are really here to help, you know, repackage a lot of the great information already out there, whether in our land grant universities or at the Agricultural Research Service, and really provide it in a way that's actionable, decision relevant, and really, you know, not useful, usable, but used by our stakeholders and partners. You know, we just don't want papers, you know, printed out and sitting on someone's desk, or report dusting up on a shelf, but rather, what are the bits and pieces of those reports that really are necessary for you all to manage your operations in a changing climate, be resilient in a changing climate, but really, you know, resilient thinking of, you know, sustainable economies, sustainable landscapes, and, you know, into the future. And so, you know, I highly recommend everyone taking a look at the Climate Hub's website to see, you know, what are those climate impacts, extreme weather impacts on your sector, and how we can help. And if it's not through the U.S. Department of Agriculture, we also have other climate service, climate science organizations across the federal government through this whole of government approach to really ensure you have the science-based knowledge and tools to help manage your operation and land.
Thanks very much, Julian. Siraj, I saved you for last because I have the toughest questions for you. I think that your perspective on conservation, landscape ecology is really unique within this group. How are humans adapting to climate change? And this is a softball, but it's a hard one, but I'm serious about it. Does the cooperative model, as we understand it, does that work better as opposed to a corporate model? Does it offer better advantages to coexist and to foster conservation? I could go on and on, but you're the expert.
Thank you, Fred. Like other people says, thank you so much for the great introduction. I'm currently at Iowa State, and then let me tell you, yes, cooperatives, I see a lot of value on how they can tackle with the climate crisis and issues, especially I see like for the small landowners or small farmers who have a small acreage of land, like they might not be able to compete with, or like they might not be able to tackle with the issues by themselves, but with the cooperatives involving in the cooperatives, they might have resources and issues to tackle with our resources to tackle with the issues. And then when I talk about like tackling with the issues and everything, and then how communities are addressing it, and then what we need to do, we need to understand people. We need to understand their behavior. We have enough information about ecology, and we have enough information about production system and everything, but we have less information about these humans' behaviors or landowners' behaviors or farmers' behaviors and what different factors affect them. And then combining those, what we call that individual characteristics with other ecological characteristics might be a better options for us to inform how they can adapt to these different environmental issues, including climate issues. Did I answer your question, Fred?
Yes, yes. And I would love to follow up with everybody on the panel. I have so many more questions, but I do want to take this opportunity to first get to our federal partners. I want to thank everybody who's listened and presented today, and I just want to open it up for further comments. So first, let's hear from our federal partners. Please raise your hand when I call on you, and then you can unmute yourself. Margaret? Oh, I'm sorry. Well, these are thumbs up. So maybe there's some follow-up questions then. Let me get to the general audience since there aren't any from the federal partners that I'm seeing. Okay. Well, I have some follow-up questions then. Roger, you partly covered some of the questions I had on the Inflation Reduction Act. And I take it that you have seen the bill. So one of the questions I wanted to follow up with you on was, you know, do you think we can really cut emissions by 40% by 2030? And what technologies do you think could be most impactful? I did want to ask you about clean hydrogen, small fission reactors, and fusion reactors. How realistic is it that they could be deployed broadly? And do you think, I mean, what do you think the time frame is for that? And what do you think the prospects are producing hydrogen in conjunction with ethanol? And I think you answered this in part, but you know, is ethanol going to get replaced from hydrogen? And is there a hydrogen pipeline in our future? And how might that work?
Yeah, I think that one of the important things to recognize about a 40% reduction in that kind of time scale is it's going to take everyone and everybody to contribute. And that's why I think the new bill is very constructive in terms of incentivizing those things. There's very few sticks and a lot of carrots in that bill. And that means it's a good opportunity for new businesses. I think that there's no question that ethanol is going to decline as a motor transportation fuel, because we're simply going to have fewer internal combustion engines. And so the question is, what does that high productivity land get used for? Well, one thing that the Department of Energy is very interested in is creating jet fuel. And ethanol is an appropriate feedstock for good jet fuel production processes. So I don't expect there to be a fall off there. I expect the market to change and the applications, but that's a place where cooperatives can certainly participate in terms of making those plants that make jet fuel instead of just ethanol and managing the carbon that comes along with those. And, you know, coming back to what Vanessa was talking about, half of the carbon that comes out of a dairy digester is CO2 that goes up in the air, but you can get credit for that, capturing that carbon dioxide and put it underground. So managing carbon dioxide is going to be a huge new business. As far as all the other energy methods that you talked about, nuclear and hydrogen, nuclear is very capital intensive. I think it has its place, but compared to the agricultural options that we're talking about, it's incredibly intensive for capital. So I think the big thing that we're looking for here is hydrogen. What are the feedstocks? If we're only going to use electricity, it's going to use a lot, but biomass is chock full of hydrogen. And so if we could use waste biomass to create hydrogen and capture carbon dioxide, that's a win-win for everybody. And I see that kind of thing happening. Now, those are big plants. Those are billion-dollar investments. And so that's the kind of thing that I think is likely to have a long-term impact for cooperatives. But the real important thing there is the feedstock. you need an enormous amount of feedstock to do that. You need to collect it, you need to organize it. And that's, I think, something cooperatives can play a strong role in.
Thank you. Any questions from any of our partners? If not, I've got some more.
Also, if anybody from the federal government wants to put resources in the chat, that would be very helpful. Thank you.
Chris McLean, did you have a question?
Yes, I was very intrigued by the earlier conversations about beneficial electrification and the opportunity to unite the power industry and agriculture industry to monetize and advance decarbonization on farms. And through beneficial electrification initiatives. I'm wondering if any of the panelists have some thoughts on that.
Greg?
Yes. I think the electric co-ops have a real opportunity here with beneficial electrification. And I know NRECA has done a great job getting the word out, but we have to do more. Because there really is an opportunity as we look at the farm, we look at the future, and it is a true opportunity for them to be able to be recognized as a leader in beneficial electrification, and it's a real win for everyone. So I would encourage more education about beneficial electrification, and how what are the benefits of it. How more folks can get engaged in it. So I agree. Beneficial electrification is key for the electric co-ops.
Vanessa, I want to follow up with you on something. I don't know if there's much that you can say or that you know, but you know, what would be the impact? Because we hear that an e-RIN, an electric RIN is coming down the road, just assuming that whatever it is, what's the impact going to be? Obviously, that impact is going to have something to do with the financial incentive. But can you talk a little bit about that?
The extent to which I can talk about it is, because it's a different program in EPA that runs RINs apart from us. So, but basically, conceptually, e-RINs will open up the RIN marketplace to farms that are perhaps further set back from a gas pipeline, and pipeline gas injection is not accessible to them, as well as, you know, the economies of scale come into play when you're talking about projects that produce injectable quality, what we call renewable natural gas in this field. They tend to be larger farms with lots of livestock, but to have a smaller digester with a small gen set is much more in reach to smaller and medium-sized farms that are, again, you know, not as accessible to pipeline injection projects. So I think it's going to open up the marketplace significantly.
Thanks. So Julian and Siraj, I'd like you to both comment on, in part, this new inflation reduction measure, the bill that came out, at least in summary, hasn't passed yet. But what would be the impact, do you think, on climate smart agricultural practices? And if you've read the bill in more detail than I have, which perhaps you have, is that going to include forestry as well? Why don't we start with Siraj?
Right, I'm what you call that. Sorry to say that I haven't got a chance to look into that, so I might not be able to put more comments on that.
But there's certainly an opportunity to sequester carbon, especially if it can be quantified and measured and verified. Soil carbon in plants. So, Julian, let's hear from you on that, because I'm sure you can offer some insights.
offering my personal insights on that, Bill. There are forestry line items, which is really great, right? Because the 90-day progress report on Climate Smart Ag and Forestry is agriculture and forestry. And so to your point, Fred, I think there are opportunities to sequester more carbon and have really resilient and sustainable landscapes for both agriculture and forestry. So yeah, highly recommend the 90-day report, which came out of the Climate Crisis Executive Order 14008. That has a lot of great background, kind of the mitigation strategy for the USDA. And then to your earlier point about what the bill may mean for the climate hubs, I can't comment on, how the money will trickle down. But from what I read is that I think the Natural Resources Conservation Service, NRCS, will receive a significant chunk to promote and, it really have a lot more adoption of climate smart ag and forestry practices. And I think there is a role for the climate hubs to continue supporting the science behind those practices, right? Because that is kind of what we do best. And NRCS is one of the three main agencies that lead the climate hubs, in addition to the Agricultural Research Service and Forest Service, right? With support from RD and other agencies. And so I think there will be a role for the climate hubs to continue to connect on climate change across the department and also support NRCS and the other agencies should they receive this influx of funds around climate smart ag and forestry, and just ensure that folks are understanding the role of USDA in this sphere and how the USDA climate hubs can continue supporting science-based tools, resources, and really getting that out to farmers, ranchers, and foresters.
Thanks. Alex, you mentioned the complexity and the billion-dollar projects that you can see in the biorefinery space. And it's true, we've seen some of those in our biorefinery assistance loan guarantee, renewable chemical, and bio-based product program. And that's far beyond the reach of the 9003 in terms of offering a $250 million loan guarantee, but it doesn't mean that that can't be a valuable element. When you're in that sphere, that space, with that much money being invested, what's your opinion on how do you de-risk those projects? What kind of oversight and risk management is needed to manage that? And is that anything that, I don't know that I know, but is that anything that's beyond the grasp financially of cooperatives? And maybe others on the call have an idea about the financial heft or capacity of cooperatives to grab that much capital?
Yeah, that's a really good question, Fred. Certainly on the technical risk, I think DOE has done a lot to, change how technical risk is managed, insisting on the pilot scale and then continuous operation for those pilots and so forth. The projects that we're seeing, these large-scale projects, they largely use, proven technology, albeit in a sort of a new, perhaps integrated fashion. So, maybe you can argue the technical risk is relatively low. And given the right incentives and regulations and making sure that they don't change, I think the market risks potentially are low. As for the financial risk, even at the $250 million level, having a USDA loan guarantee in your pocket gives you credibility because you go through that vetting process. And that in itself could open up other opportunities for private investment. But the mechanisms for reaching the kind of investment required for some of these large projects, we really need to think about that and come up with some ideas on how we can accelerate those projects using some other funding mechanisms. Then perhaps there, it's DOE. DOE typically can put a lot more money toward that. I'm not sure.
Well, they can, Alex. And one good thing about this bill that I've learned today is that there is $1 billion in funding. I'm not sure if it's program authority, what have you, that goes way out into the future on the 9003 program. So that at least gives some continuity, some availability of funds, a lifeline, if you will, to that particular program.
And Fred, I don't know if you're going to circle back to forest health, but I don't think we've talked at all about fuel wood management, especially in our western states, and you know, having to deal with forest fires and the intensity of those fires and so forth. I think we really need to accelerate the kind of solutions that are going to get us out of that situation. I have some thoughts on that, but I hope you get around to talking about that, because it is a huge problem, and it's a perennial problem, and it's certainly not going away.
So it is a perennial interest, I think, and particular with using thinnings and basically alleviating the fire risk. Some of that has kind of married up with the use of biochar. And there's been a lot of interest in doing that. We didn't bring anybody in per se, perhaps other than Siraj. He's not necessarily a soil scientist, but you know, being able to test analyze the benefits of a particular soil amendment and a particular soil for a particular purpose is very important. And I think that's one of the things about the Climate Smart Commodities program that'll be a huge benefit. Let me get back with Craig for a moment. Craig, have you had an opportunity to look at this Inflation Reduction Act of 2022?
I have not gone through the entire legislation. I think there's a lot of opportunity there. I just a little concerned that I really want to see as much money to hit the street, so to speak, as possible, because our rural communities still struggle tremendously, and energy efficiency and renewable energy is a real benefit. And so I'm like others, I hope this legislation will benefit, and I think it's a step in the right direction.
It will. Of course, we don't know whether the bill will pass.
Yeah,
but the vote hasn't been taken, and I have to tell you that the money that's available for the Rural Energy for America program, it's over a period of time, and I don't know how many years, but we're talking a billion. And the money for climate smart commodities, 20 plus billion. So I think the opportunities to do a lot of things in a very creative way with a lot of programs is there. And I don't know how impactful it will be on reducing emissions. But Roger, you study reduction of carbon on a global scale at national labs. So you've taken a look, I think, at some of the provisions of the bill. Just how important, how impactful do you think this could be in aggregate? I mean, you know, back of the envelope, kind of just first impression.
Well, the analysis is that it's going to do a good job of hitting that 40% reduction.
Well, that's really great to know. And as I was trying to say earlier, and I think that Julian knows this, maybe you can give us a little bit of update. You know, if we do something, Julian, in the States and we hit a target, it still does have to also happen everywhere else too, doesn't it? I mean, it's got to happen in India. It's got to happen in China. It's got to happen all around the globe, doesn't it? And in order to, in aggregate, in cumulative effect, move us in the right direction.
No, that's right. Yeah, part of being, you know, the Paris Agreement, right, is for all nations, part of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, nearly all the nations, is to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. You know, recalling my time from the State Department, and the US has a huge role in that. I think to our conversation, there's a huge opportunity for the ag forestry sectors to really reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but also be a leader in that sector as well, right? And promoting all these great techniques and solutions that others could use around the world, really.
Right, and if I'm correct, the ag sector, if it includes forestry, is around 11% of emissions and so on. And you know, we have to coordinate, we have to cooperate. We almost, you know, we need cooperatives to be involved in the change. We need them to benefit on the national scale, but we need international cooperation in order to achieve these benefits. Other questions outstanding? I want to thank, if there aren't any, I want to thank our participants and the panelists, the people who have participated on the call, put information into the chat. I want to thank everybody for their comments. And at this point, Bengay, if you would like to make any closing or parting comments, if you're on the call, I believe you are.
I'm still here, Fred. I just want to thank everyone for joining. And this is a very good and very robust conversation. It's actually exciting to be able to talk about how cooperatives can be part of the climate solution. And more importantly, to kind of lead the way, not just in rural communities, but in the country as a whole. So thank you.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for participating today. It's thoroughly enjoyable. I just want to conclude again by emphasizing that the cooperative model is, I think, very important to accomplishing these goals and dealing with some of the issues that we talked about. They're really far reaching. And if anybody has a question that we did not get to, we'll try and follow up with you. We'll make a point of doing that. And thank you for putting your resource links in the chat and contributing to this effort to develop resources. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fred.